we have amongst us Mr. Sanjeev Sanyal, Chief Economic Advisor, Government of India, and Mr. Jay Panda, Veteran Parliamentarian. Can I request Mr. Kadian, Mr. Sanyal, and Mr. Panda to come on stage, please?
Hello, everybody. It's an absolute delight to moderate this session amongst Arjun Kadian, Sanjeev Sanyal, and Jay Panda, all original thinkers and authors, doers who challenge the existing establishments of normative historiography. Arjun, your book is a great read, really, and it does, I think of Haryana a certain way. Like they say, you know, desha mein desh Haryana ya doodh dahi ka khana. So, and the land of khaps and what have you. But really, land of gods. I mean, it's a title that sits so unassumingly and pristinely on Uttarakhand. But you take that away and you give it to this land, Haryana. And you also talk about the invasions and all that it's endured. Whether it's the Afghans or the Persians or the Mughals or the Marathas. So it's actually brilliant, it's unputdownable, the book. Before we ask Jay to speak a few words, I have a small question for you. You know, to a simplistic mind, which looks at left a certain way and right a certain way and belongs to either of the camps, or monotheistic religions a certain way and the others are a certain way. Do you find it difficult somehow to balance it while you write that this is actually a land which has seen the Afghans battle it out and Persians, when you look at Nadir Shah, and Marathas fight it out with Jats and also collaborate with them, and Marathas collaborate with the Mughals. And also Jats desecrating the ruins of Akbar, the my favorite Mughal, you know, to get back at Aurangzeb. So balancing it all in a time when people really don't have time for details, and people are seen as members of a community or a larger than individually. How did you manage to write this and balance it, seeing the imperialistic ambitions of the various invaders, so to speak?
Hi, thank you very much for the question, and thank you everyone for joining today. You began with certain points about Haryana and suggested that I took away the tag of the land of gods or Devabhumi from Uttarakhand and brought it together to Haryana. That essentially has been an important aspect of this journey, the journey of the book, because throughout discussing with Panda sir, discussing with Sanjeev sir for a long time now, it has happened that Haryana, there are certain established stereotypes about the state, and every now and then anybody who gets into conversation about Haryana, it is very easy to say that it's a land where Khap Panchayats are, it's a land where women are subjected to certain things, and then so on and so forth. So you see that there are certain stereotypes pushed on Haryana, and time and again, no matter what anybody tries to do, a certain section of media, a certain section of academia comes down upon anybody who makes an alternate argument that you're wrong, you are absolutely wrong here, and you come from a certain community, or you come from, you're a Haryanvi, and maybe that is why you say something. And when somebody or anybody tries to put forth this argument, he, she forgets the fact that Haryana is the land where the biggest mounds of the Sindhu Saraswati civilization are found. Haryana is also the land where Saraswati River flowed, and it's on the banks of the river that the Vedas were written. It is also the land where key and important events of the Mahabharata were happened. And so what the important epics or Vedas, which are fundamental to Hindu religion or Indic thought process, find their origins on this land. And for some reason, over the course of centuries, Haryana has sort of lost that explanation on that introduction, which I try to correct with this book. And that is why the book is aptly titled Land of the Gods, because this is where the Sindhu Saraswati civilization prospered. This is where the Mahabharata was fought. This is where, and even the name Haryana, it means Hari plus Ayan, the abode of Hari or abode of gods. The land has been called by multiple names through the course of history. Bahudhanyaka, land of riches, Dharmakshetra, Kurukshetra. And in effect, this is the land of gods. And over the course of centuries post, like you make a mention of Islamic invasions, the land has been scarred multiple times because of the battles and the wars that happened here. Haryana was not a reason, it was a consequence of what was happening in Delhi. It was a consequence of the defense of Delhi throne. And as a result, you see Shahabad, you see Sonipat, Panipat, Hisar, Fatehabad, Sirsa, Karnal, all of them have seen epic defining battles. And in effect, the land of gods, the center of Indic civilization, became a battleground of civilizations. So you see Afghans, you see Marathas, you see Mughals, you see Jats, everybody fighting with each other, in effect, making it tough and making it a strange land, a land of anarchy. And from Haryana, where it's coming from, so this anarchy where Haryana is coming from, it has shown some remarkable progress. And that is what I want to say by the end of the book, that no matter where Haryana is coming from, but we are seeing a remarkable change in the Haryana in Haryana over the years, be it in sports, be it in media, be it in business, be it in economy. Haryana is doing very well on all frontiers. You made a mention about Jats, and I was it's one of the same stereotypes. Haryana is a Jat land. There are many other communities in Haryana, and the current chief minister is not a Jat. And every now and then, people might want to say, or there's a background note everybody has, that it's a Jat land. It's not. There are other communities here. But it is important to talk about Jats, which I do in the book, where I talk about how in the 17th, 18th century, Jats had raised rebellion against the Mughals. And in response to that that rebellion, during that rebellion, Banda Bahadur was a Sikh rebellion. In Jats, you see Rajaram, Chudaman, and Gokul Jat. Mm-hmm. And during those days, where you get a sense that Mughal rule was a fairly peaceful rule, it was not. Rebellions were happening very close to home, Delhi. In the Braj Kshetra, there were multiple rebellions happening. In one of those events, an Italian traveler writes that although Nicola Manucci, and he writes that although people visit Akbar's tomb, but they don't realize it, but they are visiting an empty grave, because Jats had desecrated the tomb. They had brought down the, they pulled out the bones and put it into pyre. So it was, thinks about it, it's a, you know, the top or the most superior form of rebellion against an oppressive rule. So yes, with that, probably we begin the discussion. Reaction to Aurangzeb, because absolutely. So you gave a very good start to this conversation by talking about that.
Jay, what are your observations on the book?
So, I've known Arjun Kadian for a few short years. He's a man of many unpronounceable talents.
Yes.
But I had the opportunity to actually read the book when it was in manuscript form. And I was very impressed. It's a very impressive debut book. And there's no better person to be discussing this book at the launch than Sanjeev Sanyal, who has epitomized the younger face of India's public intellectuals who contribute to policy, governance, and he has redefined the way history is written, accessible, thoroughly researched. And that's why this book triggered a thought in me that Arjun is following in Sanjeev's very eminent footsteps. You know, Sanjeev's books and his lectures on Indian history, how it has been miscast in the past, and the re-emergence of looking at Indian history has been truly evocative for a new generation of Indians. And I saw that Arjun's book was very thoroughly researched. It starts, it's a, over a 5-century period, starting when Aurangzeb was emperor and leading right up to the current period. And like Sanjeev's writing, it's very accessible. Everything is pronounceable in the book. And well researched, but accessible. And that's the kind of writing that I love, because it's thorough, it's deep, and yet it makes an impact. And he was talking about the stereotypes that people have about Haryana and the way he goes around busting those myths. And I think you'll have lots of aha moments when you read this book. I mean, we think about Khap Panchayats in a certain way, and you know, some of it is of course justified, but the way he explains their role in the First War of Independence in 1857 will give you pause and food for thought as to how do we consider this institution with all its good and not so good aspects, and how do we go forward. So it's not just about Aurangzeb's rule, it's not just about the Jats and the Sardars and everybody else. It's also about the Lals who have ruled Haryana in recent decades, and it brings us right up to contemporary times. I would like to point out here that Haryana, of course, if for those who have cared to study it without going into the history or the socio-cultural backgrounds as Arjun has done, would surprise many people. You know, we've traditionally thought of, for example, Southeast Asia being transformed over a single generation. Now, Haryana is one of those states in India which has, in a single generation, gone from being a rural backwater, so to say, to, you know, Gurgaon today represents the very epitome of the modern Indian IT revolution story, right? If you look at the Gurgaon skyline, it represents what India can be and aspires to be, despite some other issues that it may have to deal with. I think the fact that we are discussing this book today is particularly important because just this week, on the 14th, was Gita Jayanti. And what do you associate with the Gita but Bhagwan Shri Krishna's explanation, his recital, where? In Kurukshetra, in Haryana. Very apt, I think, goes into the history, goes into the cultural revolutions that have happened. Of course, the political revolutions. I think it's a great read. Heartily endorse it.
Thank you very much, sir.
Sanjeev, what were the parts in the book that surprised you? Or were there any at all that did?
First of all, let me congratulate Arjun for making it. We sat in my balcony over many, many rounds of going through manuscripts, debating, should we leave this in, leave that out. And so it was quite a journey. So congratulations, you made it to the finish line. It's a book that that is very, very interesting. And you've already heard that it's about a very interesting part of India that is often very much underestimated by everybody. And so while, you know, at the back of people's minds, maybe people will still know, okay, Kurukshetra is in Haryana, or Harsha was from Haryana, or even maybe some people know about Saraswati civilization and all that. But still, the general impression is that modern Haryana is some sort of a leftover bit from the linguistic partitioning of erstwhile Punjab. Now that is sadly does disservice to a very interesting part of the country, and that's why the bits of, since you asked me which bits of the book that I really like, and I like the fact that this book, although it does mention the older parts, it really starts with the Satnami revolt. And so when you begin to go through this book, there are all these names that begin to pop out. That's important because many of these names, if you live in Delhi, you may actually know these names, but you have no idea who they were or why they're important. Rao Tula Ram, for example. Okay, all of us drive down Rao Tula Ram Marg to go to the airport. Now, let me see, how many of you actually have any idea who Rao Tula Ram was? Put your hands up. One, there's like literally less than 10%, or maybe 5%. So that goes to tell you. But Rao Tula Ram was actually an extremely important person in the revolt of 1857. And quite apart from the fact that he was a part of that revolt, he was also a very colorful character. I'm not going to spoil the story by telling you, but he appeared during the revolt, and then he has an interesting afterlife as well. So the point is, suddenly you begin to read these names and you figure, so this is why this person. So similarly, you come to even more modern times. You know, Chajju Ram, Chotu Ram, these are names which maybe if you're from Haryana, Theth Haryana, you may even know these names. But I can tell you most Delhiites again will not know who these people were. But in fact, some of these were very important characters in the history of early 20th century India. Chajju Ram, for example, was one of India's richest industrialists. He made a huge amount of money, I think, trading and manufacturing jute, if I'm not mistaken, and other things in Kolkata. Then he moved back to Haryana, where he was from. He was a very important character in the Arya Samaj movement. Again, a very important factor in the early 20th century history. And of course, he was also funding secretly the revolutionaries. Not much known, but many of the revolutionaries in northern India were secretly being funded by this guy called Chajju Ram, who was doing all kinds of things. And I'm writing a book about revolutionaries, and you said Chajju Ram suddenly pops up here and there, handing small amounts of money to the likes of Chandrasekhar Azad and so on. So who was this guy? And then you realize, oh my God, he was like, he was the Ambani or Adani of the time. So it's quite interesting that you finally have these people and you begin to, these people come alive. And then a lot of the things you place names and things that you read come alive. You know, Karnal is actually an important place. It's not just something on a highway that you see, turn left for Karnal. That many people have that impression. No, these are important places. Panipat is not something you have to struggle through in, your history textbooks and every time we got beaten. It's a real place. So what Arjun does in this book is really bring alive these places. Who are these characters? Where are they placed? And suddenly this, this somewhat small state that is often underestimated comes alive as a colorful place. So congratulations once more, Arjun.
Arjun, what were your challenges? How long did it take for you to research? And was it an intention to break the stereotypes? Did it bother you initially?
So the journey has been...
If you think of it, this is one community that has broken the stereotypes, like Jay said, in one generation.
Yes.
Not frozen in time at all.
Absolutely. So yes, of course, the journey of the book has been long and quite fulfilling one, I would say. Because like every time it happens, you pick on a project, you want to do it, you start researching on it, you go through, you speak with best minds around, you speak with Panda sir, you speak with Sanjeev sir, and these conversations, in fact, a lot of people in the room are those, in fact, all of the people I called for the session today, I've had a discussion with them on or about Haryana sometime in the last many years. And all of them have, in a way, helped me form or understand what non-Haryanis think about Haryana. The research began very early on. I think I was still into my early teens when I knew that I wanted to work for the region. I wanted to, back in the day, I wanted to become a civil servant. That did not happen, thanks to unpronounceable names like Geology. So regardless, I wanted to work for the region, and this comes from my family background. Dr. Tarun Kumar is here. His father, Professor Sher Singh, spearheaded the movement for of statehood in Haryana. He was also formerly a deputy chief minister of Joint Punjab. Then, of course, through my family history, I learned a lot more things about, I spoke to a lot of people, started understanding nuances about the state, different regions, different belts in Haryana, and how it has been changing. So this journey of research has been long. But what worked for me was I was fairly good at taking advantage of the lockdown phase. As soon as the Prime Minister announced the lockdown, I knew that it's a good opportunity for me to write the book. The research was ready for last few years. In fact, I remember getting into conversation with Sandeep sir in Bangalore, and I asked him, sir, how do I go about it? How do I write a book? And he says this often. And this is also a message for everybody else who wants to do something, write a book or get on a project. He says, just do it. Do not mull over, do not think about it. You don't waste time thinking over and over about over-analyzing the situation. Get down on your research, start working, start drafting, start preparing a long draft. And then slowly you get into bringing it into a shape of a proper book. And that is what happened with me. So the course of research has been long. The writing has been 1 year easily. And then another year went into the editing process. In the process of which I was also able to, I got a fair amount of support from Rajesh sir, Yamini. Rajesh sir in fact released his new book, Viper, in that process also. So congratulations on the book also, sir. And Yamini has been great support, and everybody else, you know who you are. Thank you very much for helping me understand what the state is about, how you all see the state, and all of that essentially has brought me down to finally sitting here with these wonderful people on stage who have helped me bring this book to you into the market. Thank you very much.
I want to ask you something, Arjun, wittingly or unwittingly, as you broke a lot of stereotypes, and as I read them, and I'm flabbergasted, really. There are a lot of aha moments. Did any of yours break one? And also, I would like to ask you, did you understand the fact that the course of Indian history would have been very different? Because if you see the strategic mind of let's say now a present day Haryanvi, how different things would have been, and that has really not been talked about.
So one of the,
and I would really like you to talk about it and shine a light on it, because that's something so crucial to our history and to the way we know it.
Absolutely. So this question about, or this discussion on how history is written and how history has been taught to all of us through our school and college days needs a remarkable change now. It needs to be, we need to bring in more context to our history and have to make it more relatable, so as to understand where we are coming from and how to decide where we could potentially go in the near future. A lot of stereotypes were broken. In fact, during the course of research, why I say that it was a very fulfilling journey is because I got to learn a lot about the region. I got to learn a lot about those places that you talk about, because every now and then you would see, for example, Satnami Rebellion. The book opens with Satnami Rebellion, and I think, and that was the attempt, that it will hook the reader into reading the book and finishing it off. Because every student who prepares for UPSC examination, or anybody who wants to learn about history or Indian Mughal history or the decline of the Mughal Empire, talks or reads about Satnami Rebellion, but nobody realizes that Satnami Rebellion happened only 100 or 150 kilometers from Delhi. The name Satnami Rebellion triggers somewhere else, possibly somewhere in the eastern UP or elsewhere, but it's quite close. Similarly, for example, I do talk about Patodis in the book. You would see that Patodis or Patodi family is related to what is happening, or their successes in film industry or in sports, cricket for that matter. But Patodi is quite close to Delhi, and nobody comfortably is able to put together or put those pieces together and finally figure out, oh, Patodi is very close. And so this is what I've done in the book, bringing together all these different names and important aspects of the region from 17th to 21st century. But I also take the reader further back. The trajectory of the book is 17th to 21st century. But every now and then, I draw the attention of the reader to what was happening probably in the medieval ages, what was happening in Haryana during the ancient India. I do talk about how in, during the medieval ages, a secular mind would want to know that Kurukshetra was witness to a lot of atrocities by Islamic invaders. Temples were trampled upon, and the gods essentially were their statues were broken, and this went on for considerably long time. And very well, we don't want to talk about it because our history does not teach us enough. But whenever that happens, and Kurukshetra was thus a very important story in the book, and also a very important story in the entire Indic civilization. So I bring all these aspects together, and it was a very fulfilling journey for me because I got to learn a lot of those things during the research, and this is what I bring out for everybody else to read.
So, you know, while I agree with all that you say, and I think it's really important to rewrite and relearn and discover and explore and seek the right sources, when you say something like Islamic invaders, don't you think there is a need to qualify between the Afghans and the Persians, between the Nadir Shahs and Ahmad Shah Abdalis?
Absolutely.
And the important Mughals, because they were at loggerheads with each other. And also to talk about an Ibrahim Qadri, who actually fought for the Marathas.
Ibrahim Gadi,
yes. I think I relate to him a little bit. Important to really talk about that and sift and sieve and mark that out, because the broad brushstroke of Islamic invaders makes it easy for the simplistic mind to see it in a certain way. But when you look into the details as to how an imperialistic conquest works, or an invader works, as opposed to the diktats of a particular monotheistic religion, you would realize the difference, and you would maybe help people understand history better and themselves better, and their present polity better.
Absolutely. So this is what I do. I agree. And this is what I do in the book also. You would read about Persians, you would read about Rohilas, you would read about Afghans and Mughals, so on and so forth. And it is important to talk about these things so as to keep our readers more informed and have more people understand our history in proper context. And that is why I recommend, please buy the book.
What do you feel about it, Sanjeev, about this question of having to qualify, let's say, needing, like when you talk about Mughal emperors, needing to differentiate between an intoxicated Jahangir to a very liberal Akbar, that is Deen-e-Ilahi, and a very austere Aurangzeb, instead of clubbing it all and saying, oh, the Mughal rulers.
Well, I mean, the point is, I will not speak for Arjun. I'll say that the main thing as a writer is to first of all make sure that it is, whatever you're saying is reflects the facts. Yeah. You know, the opinions are to be, and it is a historical fact that there were all these invasions, and one of the common themes of them, of their iconoclasm, was derived from Islam. That is a historical fact. Now, that is not to suggest that you should blame today's Muslims for it, but to also cover up the fact that there was a religious zealotry involved in it is also wrong. And incidentally, even in the case of Akbar, do be careful. I mean, Akbar did also carry out many, many atrocities. For example, the sacking of Chittor, where he dragged out 50,000 non-combatants and massacred them. So this idea that, Akbar is somehow a liberal icon is also to be taken with many pinches of salt. But anyway, the point is, before coming into all these things, the most important thing is whatever you are saying properly referenced? Is it there in the contemporary records of that time, which are credible? Can you cross-reference them? And so on. And that is what is the most meaningful thing. I mean, you can then state the fact and then give your opinion. Sure. You can agree, disagree. After all, I don't understand why historians, why you expect historians to agree on something that happened 500 years ago when you just have to put on television and nobody agrees on what happened yesterday.
Very true. And the same question to Jay also. Because you see what Nadir Shah did, for instance, and what Emma Shah Abdali did. And pretty much not around the same time, but with very little difference apart. And again, with the same purpose, but not with each other. And both being Islamic invaders, but both with a very different mission and very individualistic and the idea of greed. So when we use this broad stroke of Islamic invaders, we do tend to portray them a certain way, but they might not be representing Islam, so to speak, but just as their own personal greed. And it just might go in today's politics to be thought of as oppression of the Muslims and subjugation of the existing communities which were there, which might not be entirely true.
So nuance, of course, is important, but nuance is like the icing on the cake. And when the cake itself has putrefied, it doesn't serve much purpose only to talk about nuance. So the cake itself has many broad brush truths that have been deliberately pushed under the carpet. Now, of course, Islam also came to India in other parts without conquest. It came through trade, it came through other aspects. But you know, particularly when we are talking about the land of Haryana and related areas, there's no getting away from the fact that there were multiple invasions, there were all kinds of desecrations, there were atrocities that weren't limited to one or two. You know, it hardly matters if someone killed 10,000 and someone killed 50,000, or someone destroyed X number of monuments and somebody else did more or less. So the broad brush truths which have been pushed under the carpet did a disservice to India, because as a modern republic, the largest democracy that human history has ever seen, which guarantees every citizen equal rights, irrespective of religion or any other consideration, turning a blind eye to the history that our ancestors have actually experienced and trying to misrepresent it does a disservice. I mean, that's still going on when it comes to places like Kashmir, for instance. Now, the point I'm trying to make is we never had something like a Truth and Reconciliation Commission that other nations that have come out of very tragic history have had to reconcile with the past and start on a clean slate with equality and balance for all. Now, I think by that extreme suppression, by propaganda which was tried to be passed off as history, we have created fissures underneath our system that have to burst out some way or other. Now, how do we deal with that as a democracy is the big challenge. There are some who try to portray the realistic portrayal of history as some kind of an oppression of minorities. It isn't. I mean, facing up to the truth, as Sanjeev said, is a truth that happened earlier. When it comes to today's India, everybody is equal. Everybody should have the same rights and access to opportunities as any other Indian citizen.
As they do.
As they do. So my concluding remark is, yes, nuance is important, but it has absolutely no meaning unless the vast majority of the historical facts which have been distorted and misrepresented also get represented fairly and accurately with proper research and backup without malice.
Sure. I mean, simply for the sake of truth, I mean, finally, we've just begun with Sanjeev, with Vikram, and now Arjun, and many more. Where do we see this going? I mean, Arjun, what do you see the path ahead? Because we're just beginning to learn more about ourselves. And now we're understanding why there are always these fissures ready to give. And there is no closure ever.
Like Sir
and
said.
And we wonder why this keeps happening.
No, like sir said,
because somewhere they were not addressed.
No, more and more people will be writing about it under his and his guidance, of course. And as and when more research is done, more things are written about it, more truths will come out. And certainly, without malice, certainly backed by proper research. And there is no shying away from facts which are backed by contemporary research. So yes, and a lot of people in the audience also are all budding writers and writers themselves. All of them are all working in the same state. So best wishes to you, myself, and everybody else around.
But Arjun, you always, there is always the fear of having to bear the brunt of being political or having an agenda, right? You're ready to live with that because this is part of the turf.
Yes, so it's part of the battle. Yes, you have to be. It's all at the end of the day, and this entire cancel culture is coming around. You have to just do it because it's important, it's timely, and it has to be addressed in a clear-cut fashion.
I just wanted to add a little nuance. I thought it's important.
Yeah.
In my favorite book of Sanjeev, he talks about yet another ancient conqueror who had great depredations on his account, raided the part of the country that I come from, killed literally at least tens of thousands of people, including babies and women. And he's spelled it out. Nobody has got outraged. He was a Buddhist. So, you know, it doesn't matter who comes from what background. It's okay to face up to the truth.
So I think we are getting way too serious a discussion on history. So I think the more fun thing to ask is to ask Arjun. He has, by the way, now got addicted to this business of writing a book. So he is actually coming up with publishing a book just in a few weeks from now. So why doesn't he tell us a little bit about the next book he's writing? That also might be a fun thing.
So that's going to be a fun book. A week from now, I've written a biography of Neeraj Chopra, the Olympians. So yes.
I hope you will not ask him the question that was asked of him by a...
No.
You're allowed to do that if you dance in that particular same way.
So yes, the book should be out on the 23rd. That's his birthday. And 24th. And of course, the cover is out. And I should be able to put it out. Yes, Yamini, please, of course. Can I? I'll put it out probably tomorrow. So yes, the cover is out. Spent around... multiple settings with Neeraj, wonderful guy, smart individual, very focused, and of course, star from Haryana again. He is the pinnacle of the entire sports story of Haryana. So we've seen bronze medals, we've seen silver Olympic medals, but then we finally got a gold. So Neeraj Chopra.
What do you attribute it to? Desha mein desh Haryana, doodh dahi ka khana.
Desha mein desh Haryana, je doodh dahi ka khana.
What is the worst kind of? I mean. On a lighter note, of course, that you've been subjected to, the worst kind of, let's say, slur or a regional joke that you've been subjected to that either bothered you or amused you.
So,
we have to get that.
I have been told ke Haryanvi kitab kaise likhne lag gaye. So I made an attempt, did a correction. Thank you. So yes. That's been a bigger
one. The first one.
So let me tell you about stereotypes. First of all, as he himself admitted, it took a Bengali to tell a Haryanvi to first get on with it and then think about it.
He had to do it.
And the second thing, let me tell you, between us, I am the one who smokes a hookah.
What are the stereotypes you're subjected to, Jay? Now that we're talking about, I mean...
Stereotypes.
As an author, you know,
no, generally, in general,
Rupa and Yamini have published
as a Oriya gentleman.
I'm not really sure. I'm subjected to many stereotypes because I don't look like the typical Oriya person.
So they say that you don't look like a typical Oriya?
I mean, I'm for example, much taller than the average Oriya. No, I think the stereotypes I do face are have to do with my day job. Which is why, you know, when my first book was titled Latian's Maverick, it was a bit hard for many people to swallow that how can you be in Latian's and be a maverick?
That's the point.
That's a good one. And you haven't told us the worst one. This was too kosher.
Well, this began. This has a lot of history.
Arjun, congratulations on your book on the land of gods. You call Haryana the land of gods. Can you tell us something about the grey or the black spot of the Khap Panchayats? Because I've written an article on it and I find it atrocious that it's really backward. That even the youth today go into, these crimes against women. So can you tell us how we can...
Of course, ma'am. So let me begin, but I'll be quick here. But see, Khaps are often subjected to unnecessary or at times even rightful criticism. But what happens often is people don't realize that Khaps are a social institution. They're not a judicial institution. As social institutions, they are to evolve. They have been evolving. And there are also some positive things about Khaps, which often are not covered in media. For example, during the 1857 struggle, Khaps did a tremendous job. Prior to that, Khaps were the ones who actually raised a rebellion against a very poor practice that was being carried out in Kalanor, which is very close to Rohtak Jhajjar. Then, of course, during Jind by-elections, Khaps were the ones who suggested that people should not use the surnames which represent or which are telling of which caste a certain person belongs to. So Khaps do take these decisions as well, but which are not often highlighted in the media. I am in no way discounting the fact that there are decisions which might not have been very popular with people in Delhi or Latians or liberals, so on and so forth. But of course, as social institutions, they are evolving, they have a history, and they have been surviving, they have been acting as the central social institution for the longest time. Changes setting in, and of course we'll see a more positive change in the
future. Encouraged by all governments, because maybe it's a vote catcher?
No, they are used as social institutions. Politically, they are declining very swiftly in say that Khaps will Khaps be able to gather more votes? In recent times, in contemporary times, no, that is not happening.
Thank you.
The way we used the name Haryana is hardly 55 years. Earlier it was Punjab,
no,
part
sir.
Of Punjab.
No,
it
sir.
Happened in 66 only.
Not at all, sir.
Okay, let me complete. And you are just focused on recent contemporary and you forget so many things of Haryana contribution, defense service, like 2% population contribute 20%. And there are more in film industry also, like Malika Sharawat and all. And there are many more things which need to be added on. And how you justify this Haryana being just...
Absolutely. Sir, I've covered all of this in the book. I've written out military. I've written about Malika Sharawat. Malika Sharawat, for that matter, was related to Chajuram. Is related to Chajuram. So, yes, I've covered that. So, I've covered all those aspects. I've covered historical as well as contemporary. I've done that.
Ayaram Gayaram.
That's Ayaram Gayaram is written about. It's fair traction.
Yeah, so what I was saying is I haven't read the book as yet, Arjun, but I was actually fascinated to read about somebody called Churaman Jat. And I think he was Suraj Mal's predecessor.
It's the same lineage.
Yeah, and unfortunately, when I read about him, I was really aghast that no movie has ever been made about him because he seems to be a very swashbuckling figure. So why do you think like people know a lot about the likes of, let's say, Tegh Bahadur, who was executed by the Mughals, or for that matter, Sambhaji. But nobody knows about this guy, and he was an absolutely swashbuckling figure, and he was executed by the Mughals in the most gruesome possible fashion.
Absolutely. So
why is it that we don't know more about?
Well, this is what we are talking about. These are the stories that need to be told often, and be it Churavan, Rajaram, Gokul Jat, all were very powerful leaders in the Braj Kshetra, and actually spearheaded the entire rebellion against the Aurangzeb's rule. So must be, there should be out, the stories must be out, and hopefully somebody would fund the project to fund a movie on Churavan.
Hi Arjun, I'm Vinay, and I wanted to ask a question around the stereotype itself that you guys were discussing, right? And typically, and that is what has actually made me curious about your book, and when I looked at the title and made me contact you as well when we connected on Twitter, right? And so when you think of Haryana, you know, the first question was about Khap, right? Gender ratio, sports, those are the typical topics that would come up, right? But how, like, I'm a Haryanvi, and I've been doing a lot of work in Haryanvi, but I have never seen the perspective which says Land of Gods, the story of Haryana. Such a unique perspective, and hats off to you for doing that. But I would love to hear more. How did you, like, end up thinking like that? It's very contrarian. It's very fresh, new. Nobody has thought like this about Haryana. Would love to see more elaboration coming from you on this.
Thank you very much for the compliments there. How I was able to do it is because of the guidance of a lot of people. Sanjeev sir, Rahul sir, Panda sir, a lot of people who have guided me in the entire process. It's because of them. Nikhil Mehra also ends up passing a few remarks. Abhizi Tayyar Mitra does the same. So all of these things have helped me to think out of the box, think about Haryana in a way which rushes away from the already established stereotypes. So yes.
अर्जुन मेरे साथ काम भी किए हुए हैं, मैं जानता हूँ. अर्जुन के लिए बहुत आसान था ऐसी पुस्तक लिखना जो कि यूपीएससी के विद्यार्थियों के काम आता. खैर, लैंड्स ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटी में, लैंड्स ऑफ गॉड में लैंड्स ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटी कहाँ है?
सर, एक तो दिल्ली के जस्ट बाहर गुड़गांव बहुत अच्छी अपॉर्चुनिटी है. फॉर लॉन्गेस्ट टाइम फरीदाबाद एक अपॉर्चुनिटी है. और अपॉर्चुनिटी हर जगह है, क्योंकि ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन इज हैपनिंग इन सदर्न हरियाणा. A lot no more highways are coming up. So the entire Trans-Haryana Highway is going to bring in a lot of money. There's going to be an economic upliftment of that region. Then Kurukshetra shows immense potential. Panipat has its own textile industry. Ambala has its medical industry. So a lot of opportunity, a lot of economic opportunity is there in Haryana, beginning with Gurgaon. With that.
Hi. So first of all, I would like to congratulate you on your book.
Please, last
publishing.
Question.
Yeah, thank you for that.
Thank you.
So my question is typically like a confused youth only. So I graduated this year from Hindu College, University of Delhi. So there I spent my three years, and I got influenced with that Western culture vibe. I got influenced with that. But recently I have started working with a startup, okay, which is a hyper-local content dialect based platform and focuses on Haryana specifically, and you'll glad to know that the topic which we have released right now, that was a Khap Panchayat. So I discussed it with dad ki papa aise aise cheeze bhi hoti hai hamare gwand mein gaon mein, aise aise shaadi nahi kar sakte, matlab isme dikkat kya hai? ठीक है, मतलब मेरी गर्लफ्रेंड है, ठीक है, वो बनियों की है, मैं उससे कर सकता हूँ शादी, क्या दिक्कत है, उसको चीज है, बट हम भारद्वाज में नहीं कर सकता. तो ही एक्सप्लेन मी वेरी वेल कि दैट दिस गुहांड वाली चीज, गोत्र वाली चीज इज योर भाई बहन, इज योर भाई बहन, तो ऐसे नहीं कर सकते आप ये वाली चीजें. तो जस्ट अ सिंपल क्वेश्चन दैट माय डैड इज आल्सो राइट, बट आई आल्सो बिलीव इन दैट कल्चर एज वेल व्हिच आई हैव लर्न्ड एंड व्हिच आई हैव सीन. सो एज अ यूथ हाउ शुड आई मेंटेन अ बैलेंस इन दैट, कि क्या करूं मैं, क्या चीज सोचूं?
दिस इज अ क्वेश्चन एवरी जनरेशन हैज बीन ट्राइंग टू फाइंड एन आंसर. But this is a churn in the society which always goes on, and this is how this, through these deliberations, through these discussions, through these conversations within people in the community, the change is setting in, and it will set in time. It's a tough challenge for you here, but I wish you all the very best. Hoga, hausla rakho.
Thank you so much for that.
That was a captivating session indeed. Now, on behalf of Prabha Khaitan Foundation, I, Anant Mala Poddar, Ehsaas Woman of Delhi, thank Mr. Arjun Singh Kadian, Sri Sanjeev Sanyal, Sri Jay Panda and Ms. Shazia Ilmi for holding such an engaging session. I would also like to show my gratitude towards our presenter, Sri Cement Limited, an associate India International Center. Last but not least, I thank the audience for being part of this endeavor. Without your support, this evening would not have been this successful. Thank you.